This video is sponsored by Brilliant. Hey, Marcus, House with you here, and wow, has this been an incredible week for Starship news. There has been a load of frustration, of course, waiting for static fires that never came, then a bunch of them all at once. We had as well the return there of the CRS-21 mission with the cargo dragon splashing down late this week, another successful flight of Blue Origin's New Shepard, and we also have some quite interesting news with SpaceX's Starlink network and some quite intriguing plans for the International Space Station solar panels to top all that off. SpaceX had originally only planned to conduct one static fire on Starship Serial Number 9 before its flight. However, the first test that occurred last week was cut short for unknown reasons, with it only lasting for 2 seconds. 2 days later, SpaceX tried to redo the static fire test, but they seemingly only made it to 10 to 20 minutes into the usual 40 to 60 minute static fire test window, scrubbing the attempt for that day, due to an agreement with Cameron County where they can't close the road or the beach on the weekend. The next opportunity was delayed 3 days to Monday, January the 11th. Now, Monday's static fire attempt was scrubbed before the window had even opened due to high winds and unfavourable weather in the area. On Tuesday the 12th, Starship SN9, perhaps just 2 or so minutes from ignition, aborted its static fire attempt late into the test window, once again scrubbing that opportunity for the night. Now, here's where it gets really crazy. On Wednesday the 13th, SN9 completed its second static fire test at 12:30 p.m. Elon Musk then tweeted that the team is practicing Starship engine starts, where the ship is held down by massive pins while engines are fired. Two starts completed, about to try a third. That third test came just 2 hours after the previous test at 2:22 p.m., which was also nominal. What blew our minds even more was that once again, just 1 hour later, this time at 3:37 p.m., SpaceX fired up the Raptor engines to complete their fourth static fire overall with SN9. Now, this marks a huge achievement for SpaceX by completing three static fires in a single day, all within 3 hours from the first at 12:30 p.m. and the last there at 3:37 p.m. All three of these tests were extremely brief, lasting around 1 to 2 seconds, although this time it was apparently intentional, with Elon tweeting that all three static fires completed and no rapid unscheduled disassembly. More importantly, this is the first time ever that SpaceX has completed or even attempted two Starship static fires in a single day, let alone three in the span of 3 hours. Now, Elon summed up this milestone by saying that SpaceX were detanking, following up with inspections, and that is very good progress towards the goal of being able to simply hop in and go to Mars. Obviously, they're referring very far into the future. Saying all this, though, it seems that there were some issues with two of the Raptor engines. Sadly, this is going to require repairs, and for those Raptor engines to be switched out for different ones, that is going to mean more static fires for those as well. Until this point, we were all geared up for a flight on Friday or even today. I suspect we are going to be waiting a few weeks before we are going to see that flight. We are also hearing rumors that the flight altitude target has been lowered to 10 kilometers instead of 12.5, so we're awaiting more official confirmation on that as well. Of course, work continued over at the construction site amongst all of the excitement at the pad this week. The build continued with the new test tank called SN7.2, with its forward dome being mated with its aft dome. This is the first test tank to be built using the 3mm stainless steel instead of the current 4mm. Although this may seem like a minor change, this will result in a mass reduction of 10 to 20 tons in a fully assembled Starship. This in turn, of course, increases the payload mass capable by 10 to 20 tons as well. SN7.2 should be rolled to the pad soon ahead of its own testing campaign, where it's going to undergo a cryogenic liquid nitrogen test and be presumably tested to destruction like its two predecessors, SN7 and SN7.1. We had progress with SN12, with its aft section being rolled out of one of the tents, equipped with its thrust dome and skirt. Another forward dome stack was also rolled out of the tent, but it's unknown at this this time what Starship prototype that is destined for. SN10 is still in the high bay and has only just had its flaps installed ahead of being rolled to the pad once SN9's flight campaign is complete. And we have SN11 nearing the end of its assembly. The tank section is fully complete now in the mid bay, however work on the nose cone is off to a rough start. On Tuesday the nose cone was rolled back inside of the tent, and then on Wednesday the header tank portion was just cut off. Now it's unknown whether a new one will be attached on top or if the whole nose cone now will be scrapped altogether. Over the weekend, Starship SN6, the prototype that of course completed the third ever 150 meter hop after SN5 and Starhopper, finally met its demise with SpaceX deciding to scrap this prototype. Firstly, the forward dome section was cut off and lowered to the ground, and lastly, the common dome, leaving just the thrust section and skirt, which may not last long either. In this shot by Mary here, we have a unique view that we have never seen before. This is the liquid methane downcomer with a portion of the header tank still attached. Now, just look closely at this device here. This to me looks like some kind of solution to stop the liquid methane from forming a vortex when fuel is rapidly draining out. We can see what looks like baffles here, which could be there to help stop some of the angular velocity of the liquid from getting into that state. A build-up of the vortex can add a lot of extra forces to the structure in uneven ways. That can cause all sorts of issues like gases getting sucked down into the vortex or just uneven pressure drops in the overall flow. Now that is all pure speculation here on my part. That is just what it looks like to me. I'd love to know what you think. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. The header tanks are extremely important, and I've had a lot of questions recently about these tanks with people really misunderstanding what they are for. So we made this animation showing why this is so critical. After the flight to maximum altitude, the main tanks are going to be largely empty, perhaps even emptier than we are showing here. Now, with all of the gas in the main tanks, it is impossible to fire up the engines from a belly down position like this. Because the liquid oxygen and methane header tanks are full and contain no gases, the Raptors ignite with this fuel, which flips the vessel and begins the vertical landing burn. The fuel in the header tanks is burned as the vehicle touches down. Now, the reason for SN8's failure was because the methane header tank here lost pressure, causing the fuel mixture to suffer, possibly turning it oxygen rich. With SN9, helium is going to be used at least as a temporary solution to help fix that pressure problem. Big thanks goes to Boca Chica Gal with NASA Spaceflight. Just look at some of these incredible shots there with SN9 getting ready for its test flight. And of course, for all of the huge amount of time spent live streaming many static fire attempts, just beautiful stuff. Likewise, RGV aerial photography picking up so many shots with detail like this. There is no way we can get this perspective without these shots from above. So yes, that brings the build progress all up to date, as we can see here from Brendan's latest diagram. That breaks all this down for you in one single snapshot. These wireframes are always incredibly useful, and Rafael's most recent design here lays out a lot of these measurements over the top in that blueprint style that so many of us love. Speaking of that design, you can actually pick that up directly from his store, which all helps to support what he does there. The link to that is in the description. Mine just arrived the other day. How cool is that? Love it, Raf. What all of these creators are doing allows so many of us here to share it all around the world. Of course, without you here liking, commenting, and subscribing, there would be no one to share it with. So thanks most of all to you guys for the support of this channel and all of the other channels that we follow so closely. This week, of course, also had the very first ever return of the Cargo Dragon version 2 from the International Space Station. There were a few shifts in the plan as the story played out this week. Due to weather-related issues at the splashdown location, the Cargo Dragon instead undocked after a single day delay to that original plan. That undocking occurred at exactly 8:05 a.m. Central Time over the South Atlantic Ocean. Now, Dragon then fired its thrusters to move a safe distance from the space station, backing away from the PMA-3 port of the Harmony module. Now, after exiting out to the safe zone, it was of course free to begin its return to Earth around 36 hours later. That time flew by, and before we knew it, on Wednesday, Dragon initiated that deorbit burn to begin its re-entry sequence into the Earth's atmosphere, followed by making a parachute-assisted splashdown that evening at around 7:27 p.m. Central Time. As mentioned by NASA in the live stream, this new version of the Cargo Dragon contains double the powered locker availability of the previous capsules, allowing for a significant increase in the research that can be carried back to Earth. Now, this is extremely useful, of course, as many of the experiments require power to keep those experiments active in the needed state. On top of that, this version of the Cargo Dragon is capable of holding around 20% more cargo and experiments than the version 1 Cargo Dragon that didn't have near the same capabilities. Remember, that Dragon capsule was used for the first 20 commercial resupply missions for NASA, minus, of course, the failed CRS-7 mission. That vessel was not designed to autonomously dock with the station. It was instead needing to be berthed with the canadarm manually. Now, there are a lot more changes in this design as well, which we've talked about in the previous episode, but needless to say, the increased cargo capacity is extremely useful, allowing for increased science from each mission. Now, interestingly, Elon tweeted this week saying that one day SpaceX are going to get a camera up here which will have the capability to show the Starfield in the background. The problem, of course, with taking Starfield shots while also trying to take a photo of the Dragon or International Space Station in sunlight is that the exposure settings on the camera can only be adjusted for one or the other. If you have something bright such as the ISS in direct light without even the Earth's atmosphere to scatter the light around, you need an extremely fast shutter speed to let in just the small amount of light needed to capture the detail of the vessels without them being a whited out mess. Now, that is the problem with taking a shot of both of the station and the comparatively super dim stars in the background. This whole issue of not being able to see stars in the background is one of the more well-known conspiracy theories mentioned by people who really have no idea what they're talking about. All you need to do is understand how shutter speed and exposure works, and it's obvious why you can't have a single camera capture both bright and dim objects in the same shot. So yes, let's do hope that SpaceX's plans to put up some mega cameras with amazing capabilities will provide us with some high definition photos and video in the future. I'd just love it if SpaceX opened up a brand new channel for lots of raw footage and perhaps even live streamed footage up on the station. Now, on Monday, Boeing announced its new deal with NASA to provide 6 more solar arrays for the International Space Station. This deal, of course, has been in the making for quite a while now, so it wasn't exactly unexpected, but it's interesting all the same. For some context here, Boeing has been the primary contractor for nearly all of the United States ISS modules and truss segments. They helped build the pressure vessels and supplied all of the common berthing mechanisms on each module. Boeing, at first glance, doesn't look like a solar array manufacturer, right? However, in the year 2000, they acquired a company called Spectralab, which later helped to develop the solar cells on the CST-100 Starliner crew vehicle. These same solar cells developed for Starliner will be put to use to power these new arrays. It is really awesome to see the cross-utilization of technology between different use cases. So yes, with this technology already in hand and being a dependable contractor for the ISS, Boeing will deliver these cells and continue its role as the primary provider for the International Space Station's growth and expansion. Looking at their transport, these arrays will get into space through being stowed in the trunk of a Cargo Dragon vehicle. This means it will take up to 3 flights to install all 6 arrays onto the main truss segment of the ISS. By ride sharing on a Cargo Dragon, this allows the solar arrays to go up without the major concern for crew if a problem were to arise on a Crew Dragon vehicle. These new arrays will be positioned right above some of the older ones, taking up space between them and even overlapping them in places. They will, however, be producing nearly 20 to 30% more power overall. It's not normally what you would expect. It kind of looks quite weird how these are going to sit, right? No information has been given for the price of the contract. However, it is clear that with the possible expansion on the Russian side of the space station and continuing expansion of the US segment, it will be necessary to provide more power for the future and current infrastructure. So new components for the station like this certainly raise frequent discussion about what the longer term plan is for the space station itself. It's been thought for quite some time that NASA may well decide to retire and decommission the space station late this decade by deorbiting it over the Pacific Ocean, leaving most of it to burn up in the atmosphere. Perhaps with a newly growing space tourism industry, we may see an extension of that plan. We'll need to wait and see. Now, Blue Origin successfully completed its 14th mission on a suborbital hop just above the Kármán line with the New Shepard on Thursday. Now, this mission, NS-14, featured a crew capsule outfitted with astronaut experience upgrades for upcoming potential flights with passengers on board. To be honest, there wasn't really a lot to say about this live stream that we haven't seen in past missions. I think what Blue Origin are doing here is exciting, but I do wish they would show us a little more in their live streams. They don't have to do that, of course, but it would be excellent to be able to see cameras showing a view from the booster looking down, or the capsule separation. Even a view inside the capsule itself would be great. Yes, Blue Origin did share some of that on Twitter at a later stage, but it sure would add a lot more excitement if there were some more live view cameras. The mission went to plan with the booster returning to land on the pad, and there we see the capsule parachuting down with the retro thrust firing right on touchdown as designed. And there we go, another successful mission down. This flight was yet more evidence that the vehicle is stable and robust. The liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen powered booster there using the B3 engine looking nice and stable as always. The touchdown on this one was quite a way off the pad this time, which indicates to me that the level of descent control that they have here is certainly not on par with the accuracy that we could see with something like grid fins. We see there the booster slow to a stop to hover and then redirect itself just over the side of the pad there. I wonder if at some point in the future they will add some new control systems to help with that issue. Now over to some interesting Starlink news. SpaceX this week were granted permission by the Federal Communication Commission to launch 10 Starlink satellites into a polar orbit this time aboard the upcoming Transporter 1 rideshare mission. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but before that, a huge thank you to our sponsor Brilliant for being such amazing supporters of our channel here. It is a new year and time to set some new learning goals. What incredible knowledge can you absorb in 2021? Do yourself a favor and check out Brilliant. This is a wonderful website and app that makes learning super fun, interactive, and accessible. Their approach is all based around active learning and problem solving, and as soon as you experience some of this, you'll understand immediately why this is such a powerful way to learn. Take this new statistics course. Every day we make a huge amount of decisions without necessarily thinking about the bigger picture. A decision can work out in your favor, or it could be the opposite. It mostly comes down to the data behind that decision. Learn what questions to ask to have a better chance of making that correct judgment call. Just think of scientists and rocket engineers that need to make important decisions daily using sometimes quite limited information. With this one course, you'll learn how to frame the questions you need for statistical analysis. What's more, you'll have fun learning it too. If you would like to give it a try and at the same time help support me here, head to brilliant.org/marcushouse. The first 200 people will get 20% off the first year of Brilliant Premium. The link is in the description below. So yes, SpaceX being granted permission by the FCC to launch 10 Starlink satellites into a polar orbit is quite interesting. On November 17th last year, SpaceX originally requested permission to launch 58 Starlink satellites into a polar orbit, with the aim being to better serve remote communities in Alaska, but this was met with opposition from Viasat over the concerns of reliability of the Starlink satellites and orbital debris. Now, this objection was filed despite resolution of a potential issue with Amazon's plan for their satellites with a 20-kilometer or 12-mile buffer in altitude between them. This partial agreement to launch 10 Starlink satellites instead of 58 was determined to be in the public's best interests, especially given limitations placed on people due to the pandemic. As it stands currently, an unspecified timeline now exists for a decision to be made on the license modification SpaceX are seeking in order to place Starlink satellites into a lower orbital altitude. So yes, there's more to come on this, no doubt, as the Starlink satellite constellation continues to grow. Now, I just wanted to say a huge thank you to my amazing patrons and YouTube members here. We super appreciate each and every one of you here supporting everything that we are doing. Being able to create content at this frequency and length is only possible because of the added support. As we watch the evolution of Starship progress, it is just so awesome to have you all here chatting away with us all and just geeking out. Thanks to each and every one of you. As support increases, that helps the entire team. So if you like what we're doing and would like to join up here, head to patreon.com/mark. Marcus House, or alternatively, you can join up as a YouTube member now. That gives you access to interact with me more directly via the linked roles on our Discord server. You can have all of your names listed here like all of these other amazing people, and you can also have earlier access to the videos to watch before anyone else. A big thank you especially to the production crew assisting greatly with video production, and of course to the quality control squad here helping me research and proof the material for these videos. If you're interested in these topics and you'd like to be a part of that, follow me on Twitter and please do get in touch. In the tile in the bottom left today, we have my video last week talking about Starship progress, SpaceX's TurkSat 5A launch, as well as some segments on Eric and Casper Stanley's amazing 3D work. In the top right is my latest video, and in the bottom right, content that YouTube has selected from my channel just for you. Thank you everyone for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.